And I'm here with Melissa Bond, the class of 2006. You are from Ohio, but you stayed here pretty much after college, right?
I did. I grew up in Hamilton, Ohio, but I found Cumberland, came down here, and I really liked it. And so I stuck around. I've been here ever since.
What made you decide to stay? Did you try to go back home at all to find a job, or that's just not something that you ever considered?
I didn't even consider that because I really fell in love with the community. We were doing some community outreach, theater outreach programs that you probably remember well.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And I thought, you know, this is what I want to do. I want to do theater in this area. And, mm-hmm. you know, up in Cincinnati, there's plenty of theater. Mm-hmm. You don't need that. But around here, it's such a fun opportunity to really showcase the talents in Eastern Kentucky that we don't get to see all that often.
And it's so rare. It's often hard to find that kind of job around here. How did you end up with your job?
It's really an interesting story. I'm the fine arts agent for Whitley County now, mm-hmm. and I work for University of Kentucky. But UK has an office in each county that focuses on community development. It's a lot of people know it as the agriculture office, and so a lot of people say, yeah. How do you have ag and theater in the same office?
That's what I thought.
Yes, yeah. No, it doesn't make sense to anyone.
I thought it was 4-H. That's what I thought it was.
That's what a lot of people think. But mm-hmm. we're out of the same office, but we get to do community fine arts development and focus on anything related to the arts and really get to foster and be the bridge between all the arts programs that exist or that the community wants to see exist. Mm-hmm. And the University of Kentucky is the first state to really do this officially. So there's only 5 fine arts agents in the state right now, and I get to be one of them.
So you said you get to kind of bridge the gap. How do you do that?
It started in our county. One need that was identified was just some organized arts, because we have really talented musicians, and between mm-hmm. the high schools and the college, we have a lot of really talented artists, but there's not a central location or anything organized necessarily. And our county identified that we would love to have maybe some arts events and community arts, and we have a farmers market all throughout the summer. And we were talking about how can we draw people to our farmers market, and we thought arts events would be a really great way to do it, because a lot of people say there's not much to do in our area, and there's mm-hmm. so many talented people that if we can encourage that in our children, it'll just help them in the future.
I'm glad you brought up the farmers market, because I wanted to talk about that. I haven't been yet, and mm-hmm. I'll tell you why, because it's so early on Saturday mornings and I really don't want to get up.
I don't blame you. It is early.
If I were actually to wake up on Saturday, mm-hmm. What is it like when you go? Are there a lot of people there, or is it just kind of still getting started? Or
We've actually had a lot of success in the past 2 or 3 years. We built a huge pavilion at our office, the house. We had last year 23 vendors come.
And that's at the extension office,
at
right?
At the extension
on
office.
25.
On 25, the okay. old Jones Funeral Home.
Yeah.
And we have people who grow their vegetables and produce. We have beef vendors. We're adding a lamb vendor, I think, this year. And people who also make their own soaps. They make their own wool by shearing their own sheep. It's a really diverse population. We have music and arts events. We've had a potter come and do a demonstration. And it's just kind of a community gathering place. It's a lot of fun. But it is early on Saturday mornings. And
yeah. Why is it so early? Is that just the tradition of a farmer's market? I think about 1 o'clock would be good. That way I can get up at 12 and just go and have some lunch there.
Well, I've learned the reason it's early is because farmers start their day very early. If they start their day at 1 o'clock, the sun's out, it's too hot, you can't get anything done. And so for them to go out, the best time to pick the produce fresh, to have it best for your clients, is when it's nice and cool in the morning. So they go and gather it that morning and then bring it to the market. And a lot of people like to go out early and get their grocery shopping done. And we like to be open around the time people go so that we could be another option in the county to get your shopping done.
Well, the money goes directly back to the community.
It does, it does. It goes straight to the farmers who do the work and grow the product, or, you know, raise the bees and collect the honey. Mm-hmm. It goes straight to them, so we're helping each other out. And it's a better product, I think, because I enjoy buying something from this guy and knowing when I eat it that he grew it or he made it, instead of wondering where the food came from.
Now, I'm not really a healthy eater. I don't really care about buying vegetables. Are there things there that I could get? Like, I would probably be looking for like your typical bake sale things, like some fudge, mm-hmm. that kind of thing. Does that exist?
Oh, definitely. We have a lot of really great bakers who they can sell locally because they grow their own herbs or use their own honey to use as an ingredient in it, so it's still a local product. But in one in particular, we have a vendor who lived in France for a month last year.
Oh, wow.
And she makes these amazing meringues.
I think you just talked me into waking up on a Saturday morning.
On meringue day, it's worth it because it's unlike anything I've had around here, and I really enjoy it.
Has the season started already?
Not yet. We're going to start the second week in May. We usually have to wait until about a month before, depending on the weather, to see if we'll have enough produce to start. But since it's been warm so early, we're probably going to start the second week of May, and hopefully...
And what time on Saturday?
They start at 8 a.m.
8 a.m. till when?
8 a.m. until noon, officially.
Oh, that's not awful. I can catch the tail end of it.
Right, and sometimes they sell out.
A 10 o'clock compromise.
A 10 o'clock, that's what I say. And I'm responsible to get artists there, and you know you cannot get a musician out of bed before 10 a.m.
No.
So the arts events start at 10. And it's just as the summer goes, then the vendors have plenty of stuff to sell so that there's still stuff around at 10 o'clock when we have our events.
Okay. All right, so we are up here on the grid in the Cone Theater, a place where we spent a lot of time. You much more than me in undergrad, but I spent some time here. The grid kind of makes me a little nervous, so let's just...
It's a new experience for everybody that comes up here.
Freaks me out. We'll just step over this very, very professionally there. So we talked about the farmer's market. And as I said, we're here in the Cone Theater. Tell us a little about why we're here today. How is this part of your job?
Well, we're here today because the Whitley County High School is doing their spring production, Beauty and the Beast. And the great thing about that is for the first time, Williamsburg High School has built the set for the county school's production.
So they're working together.
They are working together. And then we're performing at Cumberland. So all of us have a hand in this show, and we're really excited to be able to pull this off.
Yeah, that's really cool. So how do you work with the various drama programs, and what is your role?
I just try to facilitate and help wherever I can. I've tried to get to know the different drama teachers in the area, and if they have something that they're working on, I'll figure out how I can plug in. Sometimes it's providing costumes from my costume closet, my own personal attic that I've collected.
Which I've seen probably the early stages. I'm sure it's huge by now.
Yes, it is. Or, you know, like with Williamsburg, this is the first year they've had a theater class in a long time. And we wound up having 8 boys and 1 girl.
Oh, wow.
It was a very interesting combination.
That's kind of backwards than what I would think.
It is. And the guys were really interested in the technical side, but not as interested in the performance side. So while teaching them how to paint sets or do lights, we started talking and thinking about how Whitley County also was needing a set. And hey, let's see if we can work together on this. So the city school kids actually got to come and see the county kids perform today. And we've gotten to really share that partnership. It's a lot of fun. Sometimes I'm at one end of the county doing one show, and another end of the county doing Dr. Seuss thing.
You'd come out for me near my student teaching, and then you were going to Whitley East to do a Dr. Seuss play or something, right?
Yes, and it's a lot of fun. Some days I get confused on what role I'm doing or what presentation I'm making because there's so many opportunities in our area to get to do this stuff.
It's really good.
I love it. It's a lot of fun. I get to keep acting even though I'm in my adult life now. I get to use it as my career.
I understand that. That's why I'm standing here on the grid interviewing you. So we've moved on to stage here, and I wanted to talk to you. How did your time here in this theater and at Cumberland prepare you for the job that you have now?
Oh, if I didn't have my time in this theater or at Cumberland, I would not have the job that I have now for certain. It was just so valuable for me to get to learn how to be on stage and the ins and outs of theater. And as I mentioned before, our community theater outreach class is what really made me decide this is what I want to do and this is what I care about. And I had to get over my stage fright. I was really shy.
You had stage fright?
Oh, I was terrified.
That shocks me. You did not seem like you had any trouble at all.
I was the person my freshman year when I came to Cumberland that if I didn't have a friend to go to the CAF with me, I would not go to the CAF. I would eat ramen in my room because I didn't know people and I didn't want to have to deal with the awkwardness of not being sure where to go. But being in the theater helped me change a lot of that.
Now, what are some of the things that you did here? You acted, right? Mm-hmm. But you also did other things like behind the scenes, right?
I did. I got to work in the shop a lot. I did some work on the grid, and I got to help build sets. And I really appreciate that because it gave me a knowledge of carpentry as well as just being on stage and being loud. You know, that's something a lot of people can do, but I learned some practical skills as well. And I also got to do some directing, and that's where I really think I found what I love to do.
Yeah.
Because there's something really great about
telling other people what to do.
Yes. We know that's your personal skill. But it's nice to make them, like, I love it so much, and I love being on stage. So if I can get somebody else to love it too, then I feel like I've really accomplished something.
Mm-hmm. When you think about Cumberland. Is there a certain memory or experience that comes to mind?
There's a lot of memories and experiences, I'd say, with Cumberland. Gosh. The shows are one, because when you're in the theater, it's you're your own little bubble, separate from campus a lot, because we have our rehearsals, you know, 7 to 10 p.m.
I only did one, I did that outreach class, and I did the one play, and I only had, I don't even think I had, like, a real part. And it was so time-consuming.
It is. You don't realize how much time and effort is put into things like this. And I remember taking classes in this theater all day, and then coming back at 4 to build stuff, and then rehearsal starts at 6 or 7.
You're here till 11.
Yes, and then you have to go to Wendy's or somewhere and do your homework all night. Mm-hmm. So it's just a really, really unique culture that you develop being here. You either love your cast members or you hate them, but you all work together.
Are you still in touch with anybody that you went to school with here?
I am. I'm in touch with a few people. And of course, Facebook has changed a lot of that.
Yes.
You can, even if we don't talk to each other, I can stalk them as much as I need to. Yeah. You know, and I'm in touch with the professor, especially Melissa Kano White. She really influenced me a lot, and we talk a lot, and we send things back and forth and work out. We're going to a conference together, actually.
Oh, that's really cool.
For theater educators in July, and I'm really excited about it. So.
Okay. Well, thank you, Melissa. We're going to do one other thing. We do a segment called Rapid Fire.
Okay.
Where I try to name things and you will answer just really fast.
Okay.
Okay? Are you ready?
I'm ready.
Okay. And I just hope I can come up with the questions really fast. Do you remember your first dorm room number at Cumberland?
Gillespie, and I think it was 301.
Do you remember the extension?
I thought it was 5515. But I cheated and saw Amanda Walton's interview, and she was in the same room I was, and she
I was about
said
to say, that
five,
sounds
five,
familiar.
Five,
that sounds familiar. Okay, do you have a favorite meal on the calf?
I liked when the ice cream machine was working.
When that was the always, ice cream machine was
yes,
working.
That was always a standby.
I wasn't good at making the cone.
No, me neither. And usually I would always
It was embarrassing.
It was, and you try to shut it off and you think it's off, but then it keeps coming out, and then you have a cone this big.
And that waffle maker, nightmare. One time, it never came out. No.
I wasn't good at the self-serve thing, so sometimes I would just have too much anxiety about even having to work those things. I'd just go get cereal.
Cereal is just the way to go, really.
And I remember when the grill reopened, because they didn't have it for a while, and then it reopened, and they had these, like, buffalo chicken wraps, and I lived on those for at least a year.
I just remember that commercial somebody did that you're in, brushing your teeth to go to the grill.
I hear that's still around from time to time it shows up, and it actually, I remember the commercial, I was walking across the viaduct, kind of in fast motion, and I don't know if you remember this, but I remember the first time I met you.
No.
And I'm going to share that with you. I was a young freshman, and it was like the first week of
which makes me a young sophomore.
Yes. And you and your friends would always sit at those stone tables that used to be by the BCC.
Yeah.
And I had forgotten there was room check that day. It was my first room check, and so I took it way too seriously. And so it was starting in like 3 minutes, so I took off running back to my dorm, and I was running across the viaduct, and I tripped on those sewer drains that they have there. And I face planted, and you and your friends were sitting there, and I just jumped up, and you all were just looking at me, and you had that face of, did that really just happen?
Well, at least I didn't, did I laugh?
Oh yeah, you laughed. And so then
jerk.
I was like, that guy seems like the kind of guy that'll be honest about anything. And you were, you always were.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Melissa.
Thank you.